Good morning, Creekside. Happy Sunday and happy Super Bowl Sunday for anybody watching the game later. Or if you want to watch service and the game at the same time, whatever is most comfortable for you. Before we start our service today, I wanted to tell you about some awesome events that are going to be happening at Creekside next month. During Holy Week, we will have a interactive Good Friday event that's going to be amazing, as well as a Easter Sunday online service that's going to be fantastic. But before then, I want you all to mark your calendars. March 21st, a Sunday, from 12 to 2, we will be having a spring into Easter drive-through event. We're going to have an egg hunt. We're going to have carnival games. We are going to have good times for our Creekside family and the community around us. So here's where you come in. If you would like to have any ideas for this event, to make anything, to volunteer at a booth, we would love for you to email either Carrie or myself to say that you would like to be a part of this event. We think it's going to be amazing, and we're so very excited about it. And on a more serious note, we know that this season has not been easy, and we know that a lot of people in our Creekside family have experienced loss. So to the Bradys and to the Herndons and to anybody else experiencing this grief, we want to let you know that we love you, we are there for you, and we care for you very, very much. We hope that you enjoy the service and have a blessed weekend.
Great are you, Lord. Thank you, God, because we have the oxygen in our lungs. So many people right now are struggling. Maybe we are struggling with this virus, this sickness that affects the lungs. And God, it is you who make our lung, who makes our lungs breathe. Whenever you said they stop, they stop. As long as you want them breathing, we're breathing. It is you, is your breath that breathes within us. Is your breath. And is your breath in our lungs, so we pour our praise, we pour our praise. Is your breath in our lungs, so we pour our praise to you, holy.
Good morning. And welcome to Creekside this morning. As we begin our time together, let's join together in a word of prayer. So at home, please bow your heads and your hearts with me. God, thank you for this morning. Thank you for breath and life today, Dad. Thank you for the opportunity to gather even in sort of this weird way, Dad. And God, we thank you for the opportunity to be together remotely and to gather around your word. And I pray this morning, Dad, as we open up your word together, God, that we would come to you open, moldable, willing to hear, to be changed by you and by your word. God, we want to come face to face with you. We want to come face to face with your word and be changed as a result of it. God, we are thankful for who you are. We are thankful for your love and your unending grace, God, which we fall on so often. And this morning, I just pray as we come to you, Dad, we also come to you willing to be shifted, willing to be changed, willing to be molded, God, by your word and by your presence with us. We love you, Dad. It's in your name that we pray these things. Amen. So we're going to start this morning in the book of Matthew, chapter 5. So if you have your Bibles at home, please go ahead, grab your Bible and flip open to the book of Matthew, chapter 5. And as you do that, as you're wrestling around, finding your Bible and opening to Matthew, chapter 5, I want to acknowledge something about the last 13 months. I wanted to just take a quick glance about sort of how life has been for us over these last 13 months. And I say these things without judgment, without any determination, just the fact that this is what we have endured over the last 13 months. Because on January 9th, the World Health Organization announced that they had found a strange new virus in a patient in Wuhan, China. Since then, our world has been truly turned upside down. No one on the planet escaping the impact of this virus or the efforts to control it. No geographic border, financial or social standing, or any other accomplishment or designation keeping people separate from the effect of this. And yet, although all people are being affected, the impact has been very uneven. Some having their greatest season of success at work, others unable to find any work at all. Some thankful for the additional family time this has brought by the closure of schools, sports, and other distractions, and others either isolated at home or trapped in a home with people who are not safe, hurting, and scared. We've watched the division in our nation over politics exacerbated over this time to the point where a gathering of people resulted in the takeover of our nation's capital. One moment we were told not to wear masks, as they will not help us. And today we are told to wear two masks at the same time because our understanding has changed and shifted. But the information we've had has felt so fluid, so insecure. Our leaders have stood before us and pleaded with us to stay home, to not travel and restrict interaction for the financial and physical safety of those around us. And then watched as some of them themselves visited businesses, restaurants, and boarded airlines for holiday travel, leaving us disillusioned, confused, and some of us angry. We've been restricted from gathering anywhere, restaurants, parks, even at church. Our schools closed indefinitely, it feels at times. I could go on and on, but I won't, because we've all experienced it. We've all been affected over this time and seen our family, our neighbors, our friends affected by this time. This has been a truly and massively unsettling time in our history, a time where so many of us are experiencing confusion and despair, caught in the tension of what is happening around us, trying to figure out how to live, how to respond. Do we hunker down at home and duct tape the windows? Or do we push back against the regulations, the restrictions that are enforced upon us? Has there ever been a time like this in our history before? Well, take comfort, take courage. There has been. And this is exactly where we pick up Matthew chapter 5 in our Bibles this morning. This was another time in history that was very similar to the time that we're in now, one in which the people, the masses, felt very much the same as we do now 13 months having dealing with what we've dealt with. At the beginning of Matthew chapter 5, we see these people, these masses, gather on this hillside to hear Jesus speak, to hear Jesus share with them in the midst of what they're experiencing. And you need to know, you need to see this group, you need to understand that they're a massively diverse crowd, diverse group of people that have gathered there. I've heard them described as a mishmash of people, which is probably the appropriate sociological term for this group that is gathered there. The people that made up this crowd were from a varied background when it came to culture, socioeconomics, politics and political allegiances, religious thought and tradition. Just like our world today, just like our community here at home, a true mishmash, a varied group of people. And this group that we see that's gathered here on this hillside came from the shores, from the towns around the Sea of Galilee. It included deeply religious and devout Orthodox Jews with their traditions, their kosher ways, their Moses, their father Abraham, their Torah, and their Sabbath. Mixed together with people from the Decapolis, who came from the east side of the Sea of Galilee. And these were Romans, steeped in Greek culture and thought, with their educational system, their athletics, their gods, their military, and their technology. Even within these groups, we see quite a bit of variation. The religious group, for example, includes the Pharisees and religious teachers of the law looking for Jesus to say something that contradicts Torah or their tradition, as well as alongside of the seekers coming confused and excited by this new teacher on the scene who they've heard whispers about doing and saying fresh new things. We've got the tax collectors, the prostitutes, the sinners next to the holy and the religious. Those aligned with Rome politically, those aligned with the church, the wealthy, the successful, the rich, the poor, the struggling, the marginalized. It was a true mishmash of people in this season, in this time of history, just like it is for us today. Varied people, a varied experience and varied thought, Republicans, Democrats, independents, financially successful, financially struggling. Those that are employed, those that are unemployed or underemployed, those working from home and loving it, those working from home and struggling through every day. We've got those working in offices or on the front lines in healthcare or public safety. We've got folks isolated at home in the quiet where the minutes tick by slowly. We've got people longing for the quiet, but instead stuck home, forced to become teachers as they lead their kids through the school day in the unending noise where the minutes also tick by slowly. Just like this massive people in Matthew 5, people from all walks and stations of life, a true mishmash of humanity from different and at times opposing thought, tradition, and experience gathered in our communities in this season of time, as well as gathered on this hillside in Matthew chapter 5. And these people's experience in that world was similar to ours today, in being one of real confusion, despair, and tension. These feelings are because you have the Jewish communities that have been established in this area for decades and in this land promised to them by God. But in recent years, these promised lands, these sacred lands, have been stripped from their hands by the Romans. Now, on their daily walk along the road from their family home that's been passed down from generation to generation, as they walk down the road to their neighborhood synagogue, which they've done so many times before, now they find Roman soldiers that have ultimate authority and power over them, standing next to Roman tax collectors that are demanding money to continue to feed the Roman government so they can continue to oppress their own community and conquer new communities just like they had done here. The world they knew and remembered was gone. The things they thought would always be theirs and were sacred to them and their traditions were gone. And just like today, in the midst of this confusion, despair, and tension, they were trying to figure out how to live, how to respond, how to honor and follow God in the midst of this moment in time that seemed upside down and out of control. Does that sound familiar? Does that feel familiar to us in what we've experienced on these past 13 months? These first century Jews were caught in between what seemed to be two pathways, two ways to respond, two ways to live, two ways that polarized parts of their community. To go one way, the way they had seen so many others in their area go, and simply put their hands up and passively surrender to the Romans, following whichever way the Romans led and quietly accept the Roman dictated fate and demands. Or to go a second way, to join the small faction of others from their community that were known as the Scholari. They later became known as the Zealots, and fight back against the Romans, to match the Romans blow for blow, trying to outdo their aggression and violence, fighting for what they felt were their rights and their freedoms, fighting fire with fire, so to speak. The decision seemed to be either to lay down their metaphorical sword at the feet of the Romans in passive surrender, or to take up their physical sword and swing back against the Roman military. And here we find these people wrestling with what to do, how to live, and how to respond between these two ways in front of them. Does that sound familiar? Does that feel familiar to us, in us trying to figure out how we respond, how do we live, how do we follow, how do we honor God in this time that seems so upside down, so out of control? How do we live? And Jesus stands up in front of these people on this hillside. He opens his mouth and he says many things, many familiar things to us now as we've read this so many times, but many things, but buried in this, or as a part of this, he stands up and he says, "Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth." This must have been shocking for these people to hear. This seems almost tone deaf for me to read in light of knowing the experience of these people before Jesus. Blessed are the meek? Fortunate are the meek? The gentle, the loving, those who serve, who sacrifice for others. No, it really didn't appear that way. It really doesn't appear that way. It appears blessed are the strong. Blessed are the people with the big swords. Blessed are those who are violent and heartless and have the biggest army. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. No, this can't be right. The meek clearly don't inherit the earth. The Romans have inherited the earth. The strong, the aggressive, the powerful, the proud, not the meek. It appears clear that the Romans are blessed and that the meek, the faithful, are the losers in this deal. Now remember, as we unpack this, you have two very different groups of people sat on this hillside, and they each heard two very different messages in Jesus' words. You've got the Romans who have embraced and have become steeped in Greek culture, emulating and imitating the Greeks, speaking their language, adopting their gods under new Greek names, copying their art, their architecture, their way of life. And then you have the Jews, with their rich history and tradition, their deep education and culture built around Torah that was part of their everyday life. They hung the scriptures on their doorpost, memorized them in their entirety in school, and collectively sang and discussed them every day in their homes and synagogues. And as I mentioned, these two groups heard two very different messages from Jesus that day. The Romans would have heard the message at face value, likely hearing this Jewish teacher tell his followers potentially to surrender to the Romans, possibly to be weak, to be quiet, to accept and respect their rule, their authority, their way of life, to simply go along with their oppressors. But the Jews would have heard something entirely differently. Because what Jesus just said here was not new to this Jewish audience. What Jesus spoke here is what biblical scholars refer to as a remez. Scholars argue that there are 22 of these in Jesus' teaching. And a remez is a hint. It's a saying that harkens back to other familiar words that bring with it additional meaning, additional promises, and additional thought. Let me tell you what I mean. If I stood up here today and in the midst of my teaching, I said, I have a dream today. I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today. If I said these words in my message today, some of you without context for these words would hear it at face value. I do have four kids. I do hope that there is a day where no one is judged by the color of their skin any longer. Oh, and this is all true, and you may hear it at face value, or you may hear those words and recognize them from the speech Martin Luther King Jr. delivered on August 28, 1963 at the Lincoln Memorial. And when you hear those words, be transported back to that moment and that speech, remembering the other words of the speech, the context of who and where he was speaking, and the heart behind it all. This is similar to what the Jews sitting in this mishmash of people on the hill would have heard and experienced, because Jesus was hearkening back. He was hinting back. He was referring back to Psalm 37 and planting his audience among those familiar words in that passage. Turn with me in your Bibles over to Psalm 37. This is the other place in Scripture where we hear that the meek will inherit the earth, the world. So when Jesus uses this phrase, his Jewish audience would have been, who would have had the Psalms absolutely memorized, would have been transported back to this passage, to this section of Scripture in their minds and in their hearts. They would have known that he is referencing Psalm 37 and the entire message of Psalm 37. And Psalm 37 starts, "Do not fret because of those who are evil. Do not be envious of those who do wrong." Do not fret. Don't worry. "For like the grass, they will soon wither. Like green plants, they will soon die away." Look with me, verse 3, "Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and cultivate faithfulness." Verse 5, "Commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in him and he will do it." Verse 7, "Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret. Cease from anger and forsake wrath. Do not fret. It leads only to evil doing." Verse 9, "Those who are evil will be destroyed, but those who hope in the Lord will inherit the land." Verse 11, "But the meek will inherit the land." Verse 18, "The blameless spend their days under the Lord's care, and their inheritance will endure forever." Verse 22, "Those the Lord blesses," those who are blessed, as Jesus says, "will inherit the land." Bless, meek, and inherit the land, five times here in Psalm 37. And these Jews sitting on the hill that day would have been comforted by these words, by these familiar words they knew, and they would have been called to action by these familiar words. Don't worry. Don't fret. Have no anxiety. Trust in the Lord. Rest in the Lord. For you are not forgotten. Your inheritance is protected and preserved by his hand. Blessed are the meek. Blessed are the gentle and humble. Blessed are those who serve others. Fortunate are those who are not quick to anger, quick to aggressively fight for what they think are their rights and freedoms, but instead strive to love and care for others. Those who voluntarily lose on behalf of those around them. Blessed are the meek, because some things will not last and other things will. You are not forgotten. You are going to be okay. The picture that Jesus paints in the minds of his followers that day, pulling from Psalm 37, was not new to them. The traditional Jewish view was that they, and still we, are living in a time in which exist two parallel worlds, two ways of life, two separate realities existing at the same time, but separate. One way, which we may at times call or refer to as the way of the world, or the way the world works. It was the way of the Romans. It was what appeared to work in this first century Jewish time. The way of the loud and the ruthless. The way of the aggressive. The way of the quick to anger and uncontrolled. The ones who live with their sword drawn. The way the zealots in many ways adopted. There is this way, the way of the world, or the way it appears the world works. This way may appear attractive at times. It may even appear to work. It certainly appeared to work in the first century surrounded by the Romans, and may even seem to work sometimes today in our world. It may appear that this is how you inherit the earth, in fact. But Jesus says there is another way. There is an alternate reality, an alternate way, the way of God, the way determined and shaped by the heart and character of God, the way of the meek, of the gentle, the way of grace and forgiveness, the way of love, of sacrifice, of service, of humility, of compassion. There is this way. And in this way, it is the meek, the gentle, the humble, the loving, who inherit the earth. The traditional Jewish view in this time was that these two worlds would not be parallel forever. The Jewish understanding was that in some profound way, these two realms would someday be brought together. And that one way, the way of the world, would soon wither and pass away like the grass of the field. And that this other way, the way of the rule and reign of God, would at some point become the only way. And that this new reality would be filled with peace, with the knowledge and reign of God. That there would be one place, one reality, one realm, one way, the same place. These faithful looked forward to a future that was redeemed, renewed, recreated, and reconciled. Where there is only one way, where things are the way as God always intended them to be. What Jesus is saying to this mishmash of people on that hillside is that although certain things may appear to be the way the world works right now, while there appears to be a certain way that the world is established and that things are ordered in this life, a way to inherit the earth, so to speak, this way, when these two realities become one, these things simply will not last. They will wither away like the grass. This way will not survive. Being quick to anger has no place in the world to come. Intimidation has no place in the world to come. Wrath has no place in the world to come. Self-centered and fear-driven aggression have no place in this world to come. Asserting my power out of fear or in an effort to establish gain has no place in the world to come. Self-focused motives and actions will simply not survive in the world to come. These things will pass away. These things will simply not survive. Which is why Jesus makes this hint at Psalm 37 that begins, "Don't worry, don't fret, for such things will wither away like the grass." Although sometimes the way of the Romans looks attractive and effective, and it must have, because the zealots who took it on acted accordingly. If they raised their sword, we should raise our sword. Jesus said to this crowd, that's the way of the earth. If you live by the sword, you die by the sword. This way will not last. But there is a different way, a way governed by God, a way centered around Yahweh, a new, fresh, courageous, and powerful way, the way of the world to come, a way that mirrors heaven, a way that lasts, a way that is eternal, that will live on in the world to come, a way that brings heaven crashing into earth, a way, the way, excuse me, of the meek, of the gentle, of the humble, of the sacrificial, of those who serve others in love. Jesus tells these followers on the hill, blessed are the meek. Fortunate are those who live this way, those who live consistent with the way of the world to come, the kingdom of heaven. For the way of the world is dying. It will not survive. It will not last, but the way of God will last forever. And blessed are you who live this way now. Don't worry. Don't fret. Have no anxiety. Trust in the Lord. Rest in the Lord. You are not forgotten. You have an inheritance secured by God, set apart by His hand and created for you that will last. An inheritance which is imperishable, undefiled, and will not fade away. Blessed are you meek, for you will inherit the earth. Jesus spoke that day to a mishmash of people living in a time of crisis. Confused by what was happening around them, desperate because they felt like what they had and was promised to them had been taken away. Desperate, trying to figure out how to live in this time of confusion and tension, how to respond to this government that took their land and sacred space from them. And Jesus stood up and said, blessed are those that live differently. Blessed are those who live in the eternal rhythm, in the way that echoes heaven and will survive forever. Don't worry. Don't fret. You are going to be okay because you are God's very own people. Live in the way of God. Blessed are the meek. Blessed are the humble, the gentle, those who serve others around you in love, those who sacrifice for others, those who lose on behalf of others. Blessed are the meek. Trust in God. Rest in God. You are not forgotten. This broken world will not last, but the way of the Lord endures forever. Blessed are those who live in a way that echoes heaven and eternity on earth. And as we sit here today, in 2021, in a very similar world context, confused by what we see happening around us, desperate because we feel like what we had and what has been promised to us has been taken away, trying to figure out how to live in this time of confusion and tension, how to respond to the community that doesn't see life or the world in the same way that we do, confused about how to respond to our government that has placed regulations around us and restricted us even from things that we may consider sacred. And Jesus is calling out to us. He is inviting us to live differently, to live in the eternal rhythm, in the way that echoes heaven and will survive forever. Don't worry. Don't fret. Trust God. Rest in Him. We are okay. We are going to be okay because our God secures us, His own people. We are His very own children. This is our anchor. Live in the way of the kingdom of God. Blessed are you meek. Fortunate are you who live in meekness. Now, don't misunderstand me. Don't misunderstand what Jesus is saying here. He's not calling these people to be weak, because we have not been given a spirit of fear and timidity, but of power, and of love and of a sound mind. 2 Timothy chapter 1. So not to simply lay down our strength, our wisdom, and the power that God has given us in fearful surrender. No, not to be passively moved whichever direction we are pushed. No, we are called to be meek, which is not to be inactive or passive, but instead meekness informs our activity. We are not called to sit aside, to let these days pass. We are called to be passionate, to be active, to be courageous. But we are also called in our activity to be steeped in meekness, to have meekness inform the activity, to inform the way that we live and move forward. Not angry, not wrathful or aggressive, pulling out our sword at every instance that is uncomfortable, requiring sacrifice or flexibility, or does not match with our view and desire. For this is the way of the world. This is the way of the Romans, and it simply will not last. But instead, to walk in the third way that Jesus presented on that hillside to these first century Jews in Matthew, to live differently with wisdom, strength, and passion, consciously and intentionally choosing to be meek, actively choosing to be humble and gentle, serving those around us in love, sacrificing for and losing on behalf of others, striving to honor others, placing others and their needs ahead of our own, voluntarily choosing to not assert our power or our importance over others, but instead yielding to God and in turn others whenever possible. Choosing to be meek, choosing to live differently, finding our strength and assurance in God and His faithful love, trusting that one day this way, the way of heaven, will be the only way. Joining with heaven today to have the way of the kingdom of God and of heaven be the way we live now during this moment in history. Oh, may we be a light in this broken world, in this time of very obvious brokenness, because we live differently, with a different assurance secured by God, with a different reality ahead, the kingdom of heaven. In a different way, meek, humble, gentle, loving, serving others, sacrificing for and losing on behalf of others around us, trusting in God alone, resting in Him alone. We are going to be okay, because we are God's very own people. We are His very own children. We are going to be okay. And God calls out to us with this reminder that we can live differently, that we can live in a way that echoes heaven now, in this time of crisis, in this time of brokenness, in this time of uncertainty for everybody around us, that we can live with a hope, with a confidence, trusting in Him, resting in Him. We don't have to echo what we see in the world, but instead we can echo heaven, and we can make a change for eternity now in this time. What a unique time, what a unique opportunity we have during this time when the brokenness of the world is so clear to everybody around us. It cannot be avoided. Man, the time for the gospel is so ripe. May we live differently. May we be a light in this community, in our homes, in our towns, in our church, in our nation, by living in a way that echoes eternity. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth, for they rest in God and in the inheritance given to them by God. We are okay, because we are God's very own children. Oh, let's pray. God, thank you for the assurance that we have in you. Thank you that we are okay, even in this time when the world seems to be crumbling around us. God, we are okay. God, may we be reminded that we are children of the King and that our security, our hope is found in you. And may we rest there. And God, may your character, may the character of heaven be what we model our lives after. And in that rhythm, Dad, may we live today, that we may live differently, that people will see the hope in us, God. They will see the love in us, and that in turn, they will see you. And they will find the only answer to the brokenness this world is experiencing now. We love you, Dad. We are thankful for you, and we are thankful that we do not walk through this time and that we do not walk through this world alone, but instead with you side by side. It is in your name that we pray these things and we gather here together. Amen.
I need you to soften my heart and break me apart. I need you to open my eyes and see that you're shaping my life. All I am, I surrender. Faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life. You to soften my heart and break me apart. I need you to pierce through the dark and cleanse every part of me. And all I am, surrender, yeah. Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. And I'm broken inside and I give you my life. Strong in me, my faith may fail, my God, you never will. My faith may weak, your spirit strong in me, but my faith may fail, but my God, you never will. My flesh may weak, your spirit strong in me, my faith may fail, but my God, you never will. Sing it. Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. When I'm broken inside, I give you my life.